Disclaimer, disclaimer. The disclaimer you're about to hear has sexual content. So, yeah. Enjoy.
Warning. This podcast contains violence, sexuality, gore, and other horrible things. Listener discretion is advised. Also, the hosts of this venture are ignorant dipshits, so do not take anything they say as fact. And enjoy the show.
Now, are you sitting comfortably? Good. Then we'll begin.
Today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be.
The atoms in your left hand probably came from a different star than your right hand.
It is our basic human right to be fucked up!
A second plane now has crashed into the other tower of the World Trade Center.
Put chemicals in the water that turned the friggin' frogs gay!
The defendant shall be incarcerated for the rest of her natural life with no possibility of parole.
You are not machines! You are not cattle! You are men!
We were somewhere around Barstow, on the edge of the desert, when the drugs began to take hold.
Occultae Veritatis.
Now, we have the vibrators and the dildos. Now we need something to hold them.
And cock rings.
And cock rings.
And bullets.
Yes, and bullets.
And eggs.
And things to put your cock in.
Yeah, things to stick your dick in.
Now you need something to put the dildos and the vibrators in, which are strap-ons.
Woo! Yes!
Strap-ons come in two main varieties. The harness variety, which uses Velcro, buckles, snaps, to tie to your body and attach it to you. It usually straps around the hips or around the legs, and basically there's a hole in the crotch where you can stick a toy through. You can stick a vibrator through or a dildo through. And you can fuck much, you can fuck with hip motions, and the advantage of that is it frees your hands up to do other things, because you just have to move your hips to fuck.
Yeah.
Something that is even beyond that is a strapless strap-on.
What?
Which is a strap-on that is held in place by the vaginal or anal muscles.
Oh, no way.
It's so good.
Yep.
That's
just
intense.
It's intense.
Like this.
It's just like a little, it's basically like the ones, or at least the ones that I've used, there's like the little one that like sticks inside the person who's fucking, and then it's just like a bend and it just goes out, and then it's just like fucking hammers everybody.
And it's called a strapless strap-on.
Not only do you and your partner get mutual pleasure, but from the people who have used them, compared to normal strap-ons, they can go through a more natural range of motion with their hips while they're fucking.
Totally.
So, like, with a harness, it's always a little awkward because it's a little out of place. And sometimes the motion of your hips isn't as natural as it could be. But with a strapless strap-on, where it's anchored in by the muscles of your pussy or your ass, from what I hear, it's a more natural motion. You can fuck more freely.
It sits in a more, like, the strapped, like, harness strap-ons tend to sit a lot higher than a lot of like penile genitalia will. Right. And therefore, you have to position yourself a little bit differently in order to actually achieve that same angle. Whereas the strapless ones will sit at a much more natural level, meaning you can use better angles that people are more used to in regular sex to, like, actually achieve that same goal.
That's pretty fascinating.
It's fucking amazing. If you're at all into any kind of strap-on or dildo and you haven't tried one, then please, please, please do yourself a favor.
And there's a misconception with strap-ons that it's either used by lesbians or women pegging men, but there's a whole range out there. There's some men that wear a strap-on just so they can double penetrate their partner. Mm-hmm. There's men that wear a strap-on just so when they come with their flesh dick, they can keep on going with their regular dick. Like, maybe they want to keep on fucking past the point of coming and stuff like that.
So I could fuck my partner in the vagina with my ass.
Yes. You sure can.
Fuck yeah.
Can that be Patreon content?
Yes. Yeah. Eventually you're gonna learn a lot about us Patreons. You don't know yet, but you will.
Keep giving
us money. Isn't fuck my partner with my ass like a Chuck Tingle book?
That sounds about right.
Yeah, it does definitely sound about right.
Yeah. Next up are the anal toys. So main difference between anal toys and pussy toys is a pussy has an end to it. It has a cervix. Like, things can get lost up inside of it, but they can't go too far. An asshole has the entire large colon.
Did I tell you about the nickel lady?
Oh, no.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah, I know we've heard about the nickel lady.
The nickel lady?
Okay.
Oh, wait. You found a bunch of nickels inside of one of your patients?
I found like $3 worth of nickels in her vagina.
That's a lot of nickels. Huh.
Every time I went to change her pad at night, I find nickels. Like a nickel or two, and I'm like, what the fuck? And I assume she was putting nickels in her diaper. That was what I... That was the most logical thing to me. People hoard stuff sometimes in their diapers. It's what...
Yeah.
And I went to change her once, and I saw a shiny, like, silver, like, up against her body. And so I flicked it with the wipe I had, and I'm like, there was a nickel in there. And so I dug a little bit deeper, and sure enough, her vagina was full of nickels.
Is this like a really shitty gumball machine? Like, did she think she was going to get a prize?
I don't know. She's dead now.
Yep. Oh, okay.
That's the danger of playing too many video games. Soon you begin to think
she didn't die from the nickels.
Cabinet.
She died a year or two later. But
okay, good. I was really hoping it wasn't from
the nickel episode
like
was brief.
Asshole.
It was just a few weeks that she had
that was
that
a flash in the pan.
She kept on putting them in, but Pac-Man wasn't starting. She
the funny thing
the
is, this is a real person in Saskatoon.
Oh, my tips for people who want to try anal sex.
I don't have any.
Communicate with your partner. I think this is the most important thing. You need to, for example, if you have anal sex with your girlfriend, you need to communicate with her, and you need to make sure that she is comfortable.
Anal sex is something that you start enjoying after you have tried it a couple of times, I will say, because it's a very weird feeling that you haven't like feel before. So just take your time, enjoy, explore yourself with a partner, whatever you want, but just like take it easy and don't force yourself to like everything from the very first moment, because usually it's not gonna be like that. Just like enjoy whatever you are feeling, and if you want to try again, do it, and then like things will stretch and you could have like awesome anal sex putting fists in your butt.
A good way to like prepare is like when you're jerking off, like put something in your butt too, so you like associate like anal like stimulation with pleasure.
A butthole is not the same as a vagina.
The butthole is a very stretchy sphincter.
There's a reason why it looks different, because it's not the same.
If you have to, have a little talk with your butthole before you go there, and you know, tell it, okay, this is gonna be great. You know, make sure that conversation, lots of self-love, lots of, okay, this is gonna feel so good.
Usually before I try to stick a gigantic object up my butt, I put a butt plug in there like a few hours beforehand and just leave it in and kind of just relax on it. Like, oh, that's a nice little butt plug.
Don't just put the dick right in. Like, warm it up, play with it. Use butt plugs.
If I warm up right before I have anal sex with a butt plug that I feel is about 3/4 of the girth of the guy I'm about to fuck, that really makes the whole experience enjoyable. Because for my body, it's like the first 2 minutes that can be intense, but if I take a minute and warm up with that butt plug, then there isn't that moment of, oh, you know, this is uncomfortable. It's just all the pleasurable part. Take a moment and warm up with a butt plug before, you know, in the bathroom just for 2 minutes before you go out and enjoy your anal sex time.
So some notes on anal toys. Anal muscles take 3 times as long to relax as vaginal. So
Make sense. Take
it slow, warm it up slowly, use lots of lube because the ass isn't self-lubricating like the vagina is. Mm-hmm. And also lots of communication. Communicate with your partner as you're venturing into these things because you're taking a hole that wasn't necessarily designed to be penetrated and you are slowly adapting it to be penetrated. So you got to have time, lube, and communication.
If you're ever really skilled at digging feces out of someone's ass, such as I am, you'll know that the best technique is not to try to dig shit out, but to cram a bunch of lube in and lubricate around the stool and then just open the rectum and allow it to slide its way out against your hand.
There you go. Yeah, like
cool.
I said.
Don't go digging. There's no necessary
time, lube, and patience is the name of my boy band.
Right,
your
boy band?
Despite my fluidity, I'm not much of an anal person, so this one's actually very outside.
I can imagine like a Backstreet Boys-esque like singing choir about like to that.
Time, lube, and patience?
Yeah.
Time, lube, patience, faith, trust, and picky seed dust.
Yeah.
I like that.
My new boy band.
That's the new hit single.
Yep.
Yeah. First up are anal beads, which is a string of beads, usually made of softer materials so the beads can flex a little bit. Sometimes they're made of harder materials, but basically it's a string of beads with a bunch of little narrow necks in between. Sometimes the beads go up progressively in size. Sometimes they stay the same size. But basically, it's a way to stop it from going further into the ass, because you can stop at each individual bead. Some people got a lot of pleasure when they climax, those beads are pulled out. Not like starting a lawnmower. Like pulled out at a reasonable rapid rate can give like an increased amount of stimulus to an orgasm. So I hear. I haven't used them yet. Anal dildos, usually narrower than regular dildos and tapered or flared at the base. Like a bathtub plug. It has a little flared base so it can't go down the drain. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
They're sometimes curved, a bit upwards, not as pronounced as a G-spot toy, but sometimes curved a little upwards, just so you can stimulate the back wall of the vagina or the prostate in men. Next up are butt plugs, which are teardrop-shaped. They're not as long as anal dildos, and they're often a lot stiffer than anal dildos. So they don't have as much flex, they're not made as hard materials, and they're built to be worn for longer periods of time. They come in lots of different sizes. They have a big flared base. Usually they have a little pointed tip that goes out to a big flared base and then comes down to a little narrow neck before it comes to another flared base again. So you can plug it just like you plug a bathtub plug. Butt plugs are used for their own pleasure, and they can also be used to warm up and stretch and relax the muscles for further anal play.
They were initially originally advertised, if I've read this all correctly, as anal dilators.
Oh.
Do you guys want to hear a really fascinating ad for anal dilators?
Yes.
From
yes, I do.
The early 1900s? This was 1904. It appeared in Health Magazine. Piles and constipation. Quickly and permanently cured by the use of Dr. Young's dilators, this treatment is no experiment. It has been successfully used in thousands of cases, many of them desperate ones, on account of the long-continued use of cathartic candies, liver pills, and laxative nostrums. And it is never fails, all capital fucking bold letters, to give prompt and lasting relief. The philosophy of rectal dilation is... as a means of curing disease, is based on the power that nature has given the rectum with its sphincter muscles in controlling the energies of the body. Scientific and practical, it simply cannot fail, as it accomplishes just what is absolutely necessary for permanent care. Young's dilators restore the circulation and health. Our book explains it. Call or send for a free copy. We send the dilators under a guarantee to be satisfactory or refund your money. Price per set is $3.
Your ass can be filled for 2 payments. Of
literally, like, early 1900s infomercials in sex catalogs.
Yeah. So the
Health Magazine.
So that's my basic primer. I'd like to hand it off to you for the history of sex toys.
Sweet. Cool. Okay. So every sex toy kind of has its own individual history, which is really interesting and fascinating, but I can't delve into all of those because then we'd be here for 7 hours. That being said, it's really funny because a lot of sex toys are documented in history all the way back to, like, 1200, I believe, was the earliest known, like, confirmed case of ever seeing a dildo in history. It's been questioned and speculated as to what other things were, because there's been different kinds of, like, phallic-shaped toys and, like, other just phallic items found within, like, tombs of dead, I had half a glass of wine, why can't I word? The people who ruled
Egypt.
Pharaohs. Thank you. Pharaohs were actually found with, like, phallic shapes within their sarcophaguses and in different parts of their body. Like, archaeologists and historians are really undecided as to whether or not they were actually used for, like, sex purposes, or whether they were used to, like, close an orifice so that it didn't leak during the mummification process. To be determined. That being said, one of the, like, some of the best.
Speaking as someone who's worked at a funeral home, they do use butt plugs on corpses to keep their shit from leaking out.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
I really wanted a corpse butt plug.
Well, you can get one. Well,
your buddy wouldn't give me one.
Ladies and gentlemen, we give you one of the oldest and most durable sex toys in existence. It's 8 inches long, 3 centimeters wide, and is as hard as, well, a rock. It was discovered buried in a cave in the Swabian Jura, a German mountain range, back in 2005, and has been tickling the imagination of historians, archaeologists, and nosy parkers, like you and me, ever since. As you can imagine, the stone phallus had gone through a fair bit of wear and tear in its time, meaning it had to be reconstructed from 14 smaller fragments. Fear not, though. It's back to its former glory and is fully intact. One final thing. Due to it being life-size, scientists say there's a definite possibility that it could have been used as a sex aid by its makers.
So my favorite little weird piece of history is the word dildo has really like different connotations depending on who you ask. But the first actual place that it was the word dildo originated from is theoretically from the phrase dildol, so D-I-L and then D-O-U-L. It first appeared in a 17th century folktale called The Maid's Complaint for Want of Dildol. It was basically an entire folktale about her really wanting to get dick. Mm. It was like
just fucking fuck me.
It was literally like, for I am a maid and a very good maid, and 16 years of age am I, and fain would I part with my maiden head if any good fellow would with me lie. Yeah. It was like dildol was basically the 17th century word for penis, and it meant in representation of man.
Yeah, contemplating cock.
Yeah, so the
starving
word,
for shaft.
The word dildo is essentially, it just stands for penis. That's all it means. But the Japanese actually had it really interesting in that they were one of the most sexually open societies for a very long time in their early like ancient history. It's them and ancient Greece were the two pinnacles of where you can actually find sex toy history, because despite how much you would think we can find, North America has very little information available for our history of sex toys.
We've been pretty sex negative for a long time.
America's been like North America's been sex negative for a long fucking time. Yeah. But ancient Japan had it really interesting in that they had some of the earliest known essentially sex toy catalogs in history called shungas. Shungas were, I think I actually have a good quote here that will make it weird better. So basically, shungas were the first piece of literature or artwork that depicted women enthusiastically buying and using, and crafted the word dildo from, I'm going to butcher this, warai dogu, translated as a ridiculous thing, which is fucking hilarious. But it was one of the first initial depictions in public works of dildos and sex toys being used by women and being used enthusiastically, specifically for sex purposes, that wasn't censored. It took a lot long, and like over Japanese history, they've been more sex positive about these sorts of things than any other nation, with the exception of ancient Greece, because they were like, all of ancient Greece was like, sex toys for everybody, all the time, always, please, thank you.
Oh, yeah. And they had such degrees of, like, accepted, like, pansexualism in, like, ancient Greece.
Yeah.
Ancient Greece had... It's likely that people in ancient Greece have had a far better sex life than you have.
Well, a lot of the people in ancient Greece, when it comes to sex, basically regarded it less as like they didn't actually have labels. None of them were saying they were like heterosexual or bisexual or pan or straight or anything like that. Yeah. They were just like, I want to fuck you. I want to fuck this. We're going to see where this goes, and I'm going to explore my sexuality. All of ancient Greece was just like, do what you want and explore, because this is what humanity is all about. It's one of the best representations of sex culture ever, with the except for the fact that they had really weird adultery laws, despite the fact that divorce was very easily attainable. They had really weird, like, if you were an adulterer, you
severe would get punishment.
It was really severe punishment, even though you could get divorced really easy and it didn't fucking matter. But that's... Yeah. Neither here nor there.
That might be more about like consolidating power and like keeping power structure stable and all that shit.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
marrying nobles off and all that.
So yeah, the North American history of sex toys is kind of more where my expertise lies. But the sex toys in North America didn't actually start becoming more relevant and popular until the early 1900s. There was one gentleman who specifically migrated over from the UK, where it was at that where he was known for doing sex toys, but he knew that there was no market in North America. So he, as a businessman, moved to the United States to be able to capture that market now that the United States is becoming its own country. And so he migrated over with the intent of being the sole distributor, and he started creating a lot of the sex toys that we know today. Like some of the first early dildos were made by this one guy. I don't remember his name, and I didn't tab it in any of my notes. And like, long story short, this same guy had a rival. I did tab his name somewhere, but I can find that later. This guy had a rival who basically was appointed a position within the U.S. postal system that completely denied any and all distribution of any kind of sex toy or sex catalog or sex item whatsoever. And it gave him the position he was appointed, give him full rights to basically search through everybody's mail and figure out whether or not it was considered obscene. And if he considered it obscene, he had full right to just deny its transfer.
Like, tampering with mail is considered a felony. So they made an exception saying, like, you can legally commit a felony level event as long as you're looking for dirty sex toys.
As long as it falls under the obscenity laws that they were doing at the time. The obscenity laws in the states were unbelievably strict. It took, I think, Texas and Tennessee until 2013 to lift their obscenity laws. Like, you legally were not allowed to sell sex toys in Tennessee and Texas until 2013, having them marketed for sex. 2013. There was a girl who did passion parties in the United States, and she grew up in Texas.
Yeah.
And they
That's
had
a multi-level
to use,
marketing thing.
Totally multi-level marketing bullshit. They have their own weird history. But the whole point of passion parties was that they would go into your home and they would sell you sex toys, but they weren't allowed to use any kind of language that actually would market it as sex toys. Oh, so one of the actual quotes from passion party marketing schemes is that you could say, like, picture this, and they would, like, hold up whatever dildo or vibrator they wanted. As they were like, picture this is the ship and you as the sailor. Now if the sailor reaches the ship, then you know it's gonna be easy breezy waters.
This is the baguette and you are the bakery and all that shit.
Yeah. Like, they literally were not allowed to mention any form of sex whatsoever. It was in the late 90s that a lot of those laws actually got lifted to be able to sell sex toys as sex. Otherwise you weren't allowed to sell them for any kind of sexual connotation whatsoever.
Did they just, like, survive off, like, wink wink, nod nod, nudge nudge shit?
Pretty much.
And there's no massager. Yeah.
And like there's a bunch of companies in the United States who were constantly battling like with all of the different obscenity charges that they were trying to get slapped with, despite the fact that all of their marketing was put into place in such a way that they never actually said it was explicitly for sex. Yeah. Everything they marketed said it was a personal health tool. It was for, like, any kind of pain relief. Like, you could do anything like that. But the moment you mention fuck this in any capacity, they were like, here is 10 years of hard labor and a $5,000 fine.
Yeah.
For any company. It's the United States is really fucked up for that, but yeah. You know, whatever. We talked a little bit earlier on, like, the creation of dildos and the god of dildos that we know today in America as, Goshnell Duncan, who is the reason he created dildos is one of my favorite stories of sex toys of all time. He basically got into an accident that left him completely paralyzed from the waist down and unable to perform sexually for his partner. And that was one of the aspects of physical disability at the time when he was creating these that never got talked about. Doctors would talk to you about every single other aspect of your life, but they would never talk about how it affects your sex life because no one was willing to talk about it. And he, as a sole proprietor, with his family, with his wife and his kids, created the first set of dildos that he himself would market as sexual aids for disabled men so that they could please their partners again. And he went to hospitals and he went to, like, different doctors conferences, and he specifically talked people through the process of regaining your sexuality as a disabled person, and created these with such a family-owned business in mind, to the point where his son in the 80s actually took over this company so that he could continue it in a better fashion.
Because before that, they had to kind of, like, resign that part of their life was over.
Exactly. You know. In the United States, there were basically two companies that were, like, volleying for top sex toy distributor, and it always kind of mustered down to, like, Duncan was the man who was making, like, the high quality, like, he was the first person to make them out of silicone, which is, like, medical grade, safe to use on a person plastic and rubber, and
so safe you can use them for implants that are permanent implants inside the body.
Exactly. Yeah. He was the first person to do it with health safe practices, but the bigger distributor who basically held the entire monopoly on the sex toy industry was doing it out of safer shit, or was doing it out of really unsafe things. But he had more money and he had the ability to distribute more, and he was able to fight a lot of those obscenity laws a lot larger. And he basically controlled the distribution for all of the sex toy companies in the United States and to a degree in Canada. Getting things across the border was a whole other bag of worms, but in the United States it was a lot easier for one person to just handle all of that, and Duncan wasn't willing to lower his standards to meet that, so his were more expensive. And then as time went on and as people realized how valuable this was, a lot of the little individual sex toy companies and, like, sex stores that would open up in, like, New York and San Francisco that were kind of opening up as feminist revolutionary stores would start to take him more seriously and started buying his product, in which they, his competitors finally realized that he could, they could learn something from this. And so they bought his company out under the contract guidelines that they would only use the materials that he had provided them with.
Good Vibrations has been around since 1977. We're, as we speak, celebrating our 40th year. And Joni Blank, who was a sex educator and activist, founded it because she realized that women didn't have access to vibrators purchased in any place but the old school, male-oriented kind of store where many of those women felt uncomfortable and the choices weren't always as good as Joni would have liked. So if you want something done right, it became our motto, do it yourself. Good Vibrations started out being in a store the size of a postage stamp in the Mission District of San Francisco, which was really sort of coded as a women's neighborhood at that time. So the women's building was there, women's bookstore, women's bathhouse, women's cafe and bar, all the women's things. And so we joined that throng of small businesses. Over time, we opened new stores, we added product, we added categories of product. There were no things intended for men initially. Of course, men can use vibrators and dildos and other things too, but it took a while for us to get cock rings or other kinds of male or penis coded toys, because not everybody who has a penis necessarily identifies as male. When Good Vibrations started, it was really hard to find a sex toy, especially a quality vibrator, especially if you were a woman shopper. That is, of course, not the case anymore. You can get sex toys online, there are more stores, there just are a lot of options. So it's made us think about what we can offer that not everybody else offers. And what we offer is good quality stuff represented to you in a way that you can see it and touch it and look at it and see how it vibrates. Sold to you by people who have learned about sexuality and are comfortable talking to you about what it is you need to know and what you'd like to find.
And while he was solving like the problems of like distribution and like the problems of manufacturing something that's safe and for women to use, there was also a surge of like feminist thought and subculture rising where radical new ideas were coming to the front. One of them was an essay written by somebody named Ann Coate. With the myth of the vaginal orgasm, and she basically came about and set an essay that said, hey, not all women can penetrate from vaginal sex.
Not
all women can orgasm from penetration.
What did I say?
Can penetrate through sex.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, I totally mixed up my words. Yeah, not all women can orgasm from penetrative sex. It's just not a reality for some women. So in order to have pleasure, some women should use vibrators on their clits to have orgasms.
Most women cannot.
There were scientists that actually studied this after her essay, and the actual number was that 90% of women cannot orgasm from penetration alone.
It's way easier to orgasm from like a clit orgasm.
Oh yeah. And like anyone who can, a lot of people who say that they can orgasm from penetration are feeling a very different experience than what's clinically considered an orgasm for women. Because the only clinical way to get an orgasm for a woman that they've proven with science is through clitoral stimulation, because that's the same sensation that men will feel from their form of orgasm, and that cannot happen from penetration unless you are specifically working your G-spot, which is almost impossible for a lot of men to achieve with their penis. Like it's so difficult with the way that entire structure is formed to hit that spot in such a way that you will actually achieve that same level of orgasm. So this is why the feminist revolution of the 60s was critical, because this is when education was coming out for women to basically say, you should be using toys, whether you are with women or you are with men. Using toys is a beautiful tool to help you achieve better, longer sex.
We're back and there are many people ready to talk. You ready to go to work?
Yes.
Here we go.
Hello, you are on the air.
Hello, Dr. Ruth.
Hello.
I'm Joan from Florida.
Yes.
My fiancé and I enjoy terrific oral sex and mutual masturbation.
Yes.
The few times we've had intercourse have been great.
Yes.
I'm 47 and Art is 59.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. The problem I'm having is that Art expects this great intercourse and climax from me with all the fireworks. I'm scared because in my entire life I've only experienced internal climax maybe 10 times.
Wait, let me tell you something. You better tell him that there is no such thing as a vaginal, what you call internal, orgasm as against clitoral orgasm.
Okay.
Because an orgasm is an orgasm. They used to talk about that. They used to think that because Sigmund Freud, you know, the great psychologist,
right,
used to teach that there are two different types of orgasms, a vaginal and a clitoral one, and that the woman who needs clitoral stimulation is an immature woman.
Uh-huh.
That's nonsense. Sigmund Freud, Joan, just didn't know.
Right.
The data that we know today from Masters and Johnson and Helen Singer Kaplan, you know, all these researchers.
Right.
So you have to tell him to relax. And then you have to tell him that the main thing for you, Joan,
yes,
is to have an orgasm. And it doesn't matter if it is through oral or, you know, with a hand.
Right.
Or maybe with his nose. It doesn't matter with what it is being brought about.
All right.
But that he should not have, Joan, he should not have these unrealistic expectations.
All right.
Okay?
Thank you so much.
Will you let me know? Will you call us again?
I sure will.
Thank you so much, Joan.
Thank you.
Good luck.
And thank you.
Mm-hmm. And it's hard to explain, like, what the concept was back then, like, what the mindset was back then. But just to give you an example, like, There were theories and psychological thought being put out by universities that, and like in schools of psychology, that a vaginal orgasm, a penetrative orgasm, was a mature woman's orgasm, while a clitoral orgasm was an immature little girl's orgasm, and grown women should not have them. This is a quote from Norman Mailer, a political...
Fuck you, Norman Mailer.
A political commentator of the time. He wrote a book called Prisoners of Sex, where he posited that women pursuing their own pleasure were trapping themselves inside of a self-perpetuating cycle of disappointment. This is a quote from his book. The laboratory dildo, the vibrator, provides an emasculating plenitude of orgasms that men cannot compete with.
Well.
It's like, don't give yourselves pleasure. We can't keep up with that. Like, that was his argument back then.
How dare you want better than what we can give you?
Yeah.
Ironically, there was also an entire side of the feminist movement that believed that sex toys were incredibly awful and degrading,
yep,
for lesbian relationships.
Yeah.
Like, lesbian feminists in the 60s, there was like an entire sector of them that was really gung-ho on sex toys being able to be more publicized because they were able to be healthier, give you better sex lives. And a lot of dildos, when they started coming out with ones that were female-oriented and actually got word, were such a strong feminist symbol because it was them saying, we're taking our own pleasure back. This is our thing now, and we have the right to do this as much as we please. But mm-hmm. there were feminists completely on the other side that were saying, if you're using toys to supplement your sex, then clearly you're disobeying the natural order of women being able to pleasure each other. And it was like, it was such a weird reversal of, like, men were saying, these don't pleasure you the way that I can, and women were saying, these don't pleasure you the way that I can. It was almost like they kind of, from opposite points of the spectrum, fought for the same thing, and then there was everyone else in the middle who's like, but also this is fucking amazing.
Yeah.
And it's really critical for queer people to be able to feel like we can have sex in a very safe way, because this was also when... Like, if like the 60s revolution of this and the feminist argument started to roll into the 80s when the AIDS epidemic was becoming really large.
Oh, yes.
And it had a huge impact on gay people being able to actually have sex again while this epidemic was happening.
And having it safely
because it meant that you weren't going to be transmitting diseases if you were practicing safe sex with instruments and with other assisted toys. Then it meant that you could... Well, you could avoid like a scenario like this. If you created fluid bonded toys with each other that were specifically only for that person, then you were creating a much safer environment for people to actually foster love and sex and creativity within their bedroom.
And it started in the 60s, but like the conversation kept on evolving. Like in the 60s, the feminist sex toy revolution was still very much white, middle-class, heterosexual women.
Absolutely.
And it took a long time for women of color, women that are non-binary, like people of all different types to start to be able to participate in that circle. And even in the middle-class white feminist circles, there are still disagreements. Like, some of them were arguing, like, you shouldn't be fighting for rights in the bedroom, you should be fighting for rights in the boardroom. They were basically saying, like, you're wasting your time with sex toys when we're on the street trying to gain our rights. So you're wasting your time with toys while we're trying to create a political revolution. There was a bunch of, like, whataboutism about that. Like, people can't do two things at the same time.
It's not sorry. Pie, bitches.
Yeah. Sorry on behalf of cis white women.
Yeah, I know. It's
yeah, sorry.
Sorry on behalf of my entire fucking history.
Two on your ace, like, you seek out, like, sex for fun or mm-hmm. just to get off or something. And sometimes you don't want that interaction with the other person because you're not sexually attracted to them. So you go to toys just to relieve yourself of that.
Mm.
Yep.
Yeah, because that release of endorphins always feels good. Helps cup sleep. Of coffee in the morning.
Absolutely. Yeah.
There was a woman in the United States who opened one of the first feminist sex store toys. Her last name was Bright. I can't remember her first name.
Feel like her first name should have been Sarah.
With an H.
Might be right. I think Sarah Bright is right.
Perfect.
Now that you're saying it, that sounds very right. Don't quote me on that. Quote Haley Lieberman, the author of Buzz, a stimulating history of the sex toy. She's great. But she opened one of the first 1960s feminist sex toy stores in San Francisco called Good Vibrations. And they were the ones who worked with Goshnell Duncan on creating dildos for women and eventually got it more widespread. She was a goddess. She also worked very closely with a bunch of different feminists who worked very hard on female sex education.
Oh, yeah.
I am very pleased to introduce our longtime partner, Susie Bright. So you're one of the pioneers of the sex-positive feminist.
That's right.
So talk to us about what that is.
Yeah, sex-positive is a funny word, isn't it? It's one of those hyphenated things. You're not quite sure what sort of animal it means. It is thought of as a modern term because of an issue in the contemporary women's movement that came up in the late 70s and 80s. Everyone who was interested in feminism was on the same page when it came to anatomy. You know, you had a book like Our Bodies Ourselves. Everyone was like, I want to be involved in how my baby's born, and I want birth control, and, you know, what about abortion rights, and here's my cervix, damn it, you know, and and there was this, like, picture, there was a famous poster of Wonder Woman with a speculum in her hand, and she said, with my speculum, I can fight. On the physiology of women's education and kind of, like, rattling the bars and saying, if you knew how our uteruses worked, we wouldn't have all these stupid laws that keep women so frightened and oppressed and in perilous situations. So everything was going along very nicely, but then when we started to talk about what was above the neck and the kind of things you might think about sex, your desires, your fantasies, the way you imagined yourself, your erotic identity, your sexual philosophy, all of that is very psychological, it's deep, it's highly individual and idiosyncratic and imaginative, and that's when there started to be these fissures between people like myself, who was saying imagination good, freedom of expression, it doesn't hurt you to think about this. Prudery kills, but nobody ever dropped dead from, you know, seeing a sexual idea in print or hearing one. I always was emphasizing that. I would say, so, how many people died because they saw a naked picture? Please, you know, show me the corpses littered on the floor. I mean, you might say, I don't like that, or it offended me, or it's not my thing, or you might feel deeply moved and not even know why, but nevertheless, it is part of your education and your history.
There was a feminist from the 60s who would run workshops where it was basically a bunch of women who were all naked with mirrors learning how to use their own vagina for pleasure. And she ran workshops specifically based on this to get other women more comfortable and empowered with their own genitalia to be able to actually create better sex relationships. And in that, Sarah Bright worked with her to like educate them as well on like sex toys and the use of those things within interpersonal relationships, mm-hmm. and to help foster like this toy works really well for this part of your anatomy. And they ended up going to conferences and speaking on these kind of terms together, which was super controversial in the '60s of them actually being like, hey, vaginas are neat as fuck and you can use them in great ways that are not just to stick dicks in.
Yeah.
And like jerking off has always been like, it's always been a baseline pleasure, and I'm sure it's a baseline pleasure for all kinds of people. It's, you know, it's an endorphin rush, it's a stress relief, and like for men and male presenting people, it hasn't been stigmatized to be able to jerk off to have sexual pleasure. But for years, women have had to fight for even the concept of being able to pleasure themselves guilt free, and having the materials available and having the education available to be able to do that.
Well, how dare a woman have an orgasm without a man?
Yeah, or even be aware of her own body and like her and like what her pussy looks like and the different parts and what she can do with them and all that.
For any of you that are thinking about, huh, do I actually know what my pussy looks like? Pause this right now. Go find a fucking hand mirror and examine your fucking genitalia for like 10 minutes. Know how it works. Stare it in the face, because your sex life will thank you. Knowing what you look like and how you work is going to be critical to having a successful sex life for the rest of your life.
My partner actually told me about a girl who was 16 and did not know what her clit was.
Big that,
I'm sure that's not uncommon.
It's not uncommon. And this is exactly what Bright and whatever her name is, we're trying to fight. They were trying to teach women about how to be able to pleasure themselves so that they could then teach other people, teach other partners, because like they were the originators of the masturbation party where women could just get together and masturbate and try new things that would work for them so that they could teach it to partners going forward and just to liberate themselves.
Yeah. Alrighty. That's all I have. Do you have anything else to add?
Does anyone have questions?
Yeah.
Anything? Any like part of weird history that I'm forgetting is probably in the back of my brain, but I don't remember it. If you have any like part of sex toy history you're interested in, I can answer those questions.
What's your favorite sex toy around the circle?
Oh,
starting with Ood.
Oh man, for it depends on the partner, because there's a lot of different, like depending on the partner, I like to do things that partners generally enjoy. Like there's toys that I'll use on people that I might not enjoy myself, but just because they get off so much on them, I really enjoy using them. But I don't know, for myself, I have a little like a pocket pussy egg thing, and it's giving me hours of fun.
Not that we talked about it today, but I guess it's more of like it's not directly a sex toy, but my favorite thing to use in sexual contents is electrostim.
Oh, those are fun.
Electrostim is a very good time.
Oh yeah,
because you could use it on either gender. I use it on my partner primarily, but whenever he gets to use it on me, we also have. You can also connect those up to electric floggers that are real intense if you're willing to like, kind of amp it up to that level.
And anything made of good quality metal becomes a toy.
Exactly. That being said, if you want to talk about like kind of the more classic, like the toys that we were talking about today, Hitachi Magic Wand always wins.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, kinky sex toys will be their own episode. I kind of decided that when I tried to start to go into that, it's just too broad.
Yeah.
It needs to be its own episode.
Totally.
Yeah.
I haven't used a lot, but I have this one. It's literally a back massager.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's very,
or is it?
Very powerful. You know, it does its job. One thing I imagine that I would probably like is like being tied up with like soft stuff. And
Go listen to our BDSM episode.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Richard Bigley's going to start laughing at this already because he knows what the fucking answer is. A cantaloupe with a hole cut in the side.
Oh yeah. I won't lie. That's one of the only reasons I've ever like been curious as to what it would be like to have a penis ahead sensation is because I'm so curious what that feels like.
Yeah.
There's no way you can replicate that with like my genitalia.
No.
Not until you get to like jack into the Matrix levels too.
No.
Thing you will find out if you do try to fuck a cantaloupe with a penis is that the suction will get it stuck on.
Oh no.
So I mean not hopelessly stuck that you can't pull your dick out of it, you just wait for it to get soft and pull it out. But you have to drill a ventilation hole in the top in order to equalize the pressure going in and out, and then it's fabulous.
Oh yeah.
Fabulous.
That sounds magic.
Only twice in my life because it's a pain in the ass to get a cantaloupe and try to cut the right size hole out and get on but when you finally do it, if you have a partner with a penis, try it out because it's a lot.
Have you
of
ever?
Fun.
You've never had issues with like any kind of like contamination or anything? Like,
no,
that's like that's a fear that I think I had. Is I was like, what if I get some kind of an infection from like cantaloupe juice going up?
No, like I have full foreskin, and you just clean it out afterward, and you're fine.
Oh, okay, cool, neat.
Well, mine is not quite as exotic as that. It's like a good old vibrator.
Yeah. What kind of a vibrator?
Just like a small one.
Okay.
It's like a little...
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Pocket size.
A lady finger?
Yeah.
Yeah, just a little zip-zap-zop one.
I found my mom's vibrator once when I was a kid. It was,
oh, no.
It said lady finger right on the side of it, and I had no idea what it was until like a decade later, and I'm like, oh, Jesus Christ. Like, I touched it.
That was, I think, one of my past partners actually talked about this. His dad passed away when he was fairly young, and he was the oldest of his family and had to clean out a bunch of his dad's stuff, and he's like, I know this is going to be my kids in the future, but like, fuck, I did not like having to enjoy cleaning out all of my dad's sex toys and porn. Oh, God,
my dad's porn that I just had not
expected
at all.
That's one of those things where you're like, I gotta fucking clean this shit out, but like, God, I don't want to think about this.
Yeah, that's my friend's father. She tells a story about cleaning her mom and her cleaning her dad's stuff out, and her mom was like, oh, I'm so sorry about all the stuff your father had, and she's like, oh, okay, you haven't gotten to the trans porn yet, have you? And her mom was like, what?
Do any of you still save your porn, or are you just like online websites all the time?
Online websites.
I mean, like, I'll have bookmarks of a couple of things. Like,
yeah.
I haven't consumed porn regularly since I was like 18 years old. It's just never been a thing for me since. But I've definitely like caught in my head the first like 3 porn videos that I ever watched in my entire life.
Yeah.
And one of them, which was like hugely influential to me as a young man, was a video on a website that doesn't exist anymore called Cam Playtime. And it was a 30 something woman who was just masturbating on a bar stool. And up until that point in my life, I had no idea what female genitalia looked like.
Oh,
and it was some pretty up close stuff. And I was like, oh my God.
Your poor little brain was just like,
oh my God, that's incredible. And she does that with it and it makes that happen. And like, thanks to her for like every partner with a vulva I've had since then, because she's
out there. I'm sure
she's benefited from Cam Playtime Girl.
I'm sure that Cam Playtime Girl is out there listening and one of your favorite people, and she'll just never tell you.
Thanks. Like, thank all my female partners. Thank you.
Oh, excellent.
Yes. Because of you on your bar stool, I know how to please a woman.
Yeah, I think that's a good note to end off on. You know, we come a long way. We've gripped our pleasure and kind of taken a bit of hold of what we want and what we want to experience in our lives.
But get the fuck out of my house.
We can, you know, we can all go a little farther. So I employ all the listeners out there to do a little exploration yourself. Find out what you like.
Try things. Try out things. Yeah. Try, and if you need to try cheap versions to find the expensive ones you like, it's worth it. Play safely, and don't be afraid to ask for shit. If someone shames you for what you ask for, then dump them and move on.
Yep. For Occultae Veritatis, I'm Mood Gallifrey.
Fish Murray.
Leon Filger.
And in studio with us,
Hot Bitch.
And Squishy.
There you go. Have a good night.
Love you. Bye.
Cheers.
Bye.
Alrighty, part 2 of our sex toy case. Hope you enjoyed it. Now, to play us out, here is Bad Ronald and his song, Sex Toy. Enjoy and see you in the after show.
Call me when you're feeling blue, when your boyfriend up and
You know, here at Occultae Veritatis, all three of us are very quick to thank our patrons and thank our listeners and all that, and we just like to reiterate that. You know, this podcast started out as a goofy idea between three friends who had a little too much comfort with each other. We could talk in a way with each other that we could talk with barely anyone else. Like, very, very openly, mask off, like, no filter, all that good stuff. And we've seen each other in various states of, like, our life. Like, and the fact that there's people out there that want to sit down and listen to us and put us in your ear canals every week and let us listen and find us interesting and find us funny and hell, think that we might even be doing, like, any good at all covering this crap. And, you know, if any of you are out there listening or you've been tagging along for a little while or a long while, just thank you very much, because without you guys, without the listeners, without people telling their friends and donating to the Patreon and supporting us and just, like, just listening in general, just listening to the podcast, we would be nowhere. We would be shouting into the void. So, from the bottom of my heart, and I'm sure it comes from Sage and Leon as well, thank you very much. And when we get back from our summer vacations and all that stuff, we're going to be doing a whole bunch of recording, and we're going to be getting back into all three of us having after shows. So we're going to be reading your emails, we're going to be announcing new patrons, we're going to be doing some awesome stuff. So stay tuned. Oh, and if you want to send an email, just at ovfeedback@gmail.com. Have a wonderful evening, wherever you are, whatever you're doing. Bye-bye.